My name is Ahmed, I'm Asiwaju Tinubu's personal visual storyteller.
When I'm being asked, how is working with Asiwaju like? It's like the most interesting conversation I always want to have. Like, how is working with Asiwaju like? I'm like, amazing. And the next question I get is, how is he? Like, how is he like? I'm like, Asiwaju is like the most interesting person to tell his story. I started working with him officially end of January, and it's been the most interesting 7 to 8 months thereabout of my life, meaning I've had to make a lot of adjustments. I've had to learn things quickly and learn things really fast. I used to consider myself very, very much hardworking, but I've had to question myself a lot of times having to work with Asiwaju Bola Ahmed Tinubu. Yes, somebody that you would go to bed and, you know, he's done talking to people late at night at 3 a.m., 4 a.m. And then I'm getting to my apartment, picking up my phone to just see what is going on. If there's any message on my WhatsApp, and I'm seeing message on the group saying, oh, we are leaving or we're traveling to Gombe or Jigawa, or we'll be going to Gombe, Jigawa and Kano by 8 o'clock in the morning. And I'm like, Nosa, how old are you? I'm like, 20 plus. This man is 70. You should sleep. I need to sleep. And then I'm like, I need to rest. And you wake up in the morning and then you get to his apartment and you see him. He's up and he's like, good morning. You know, that's the way he says it's good morning, that you would hear it. It's like, good morning. And everybody's like, good morning. I know we're trying to, and the man is just going to get into the car and get to the airport. And then it's going again. And we're like, oh. And then, you know, sometimes we're like, can we not just go to the third state and just go back home? And then it's like, we're going to the third state. And we get to the third state. We get back to Abuja at midnight. And the next thing is, we see cars waiting to see him. And I'm like, no, no way. It's not possible. Don't do this. And the next thing is, you know, probably gets dinner and then sits down. And then he's meeting people and he's talking to people. And I know a lot of people at my age that can't even walk half as hard as I walk. That once it's a particular time, they can't keep going as much as I keep going. Not to talk of somebody that is even the one that is even pushing me and even motivating me, and let me use the word, giving me the ginger to keep going hard. So to me, the question is not about the age. I ask people, would you rather have a 45-year-old man that is not as hardworking and that is not as competent? Or you'd have a 70-year-old man that is competent, that is hardworking, and that won't go to sleep until there's a solution to a Nigerian problem? That's the question we should ask. We can continue to place sentiment and say, oh, the age factor. But we can also be truthful about it. And instead of being sentimental and, you know, what have you, and ask ourselves the question. So, you know, it was just very intentional about what he needs to do. Oh, we still need to go visit this place. Oh, there's an attack. We need to go there. You know, we need to call people. We need to do this. And you could see that sincerely. And this is the funny thing. I mean, I've only been working here for 8 months, but there are people that have been working with him for years. And when you find out from those people, it's been like that, you know, for so long. It's been like that, but, you know, maybe because it wasn't running at that time, you would, you know, some of those things were not really, really, you know, pushed or publicized or used. But it's always been like that when you find out. And you will see that he's been consistent in how much he's been showing up for people at the time of their need. So outside, you know, whatever anyone will say, I've come to work with someone that I know that he sincerely cares for people. And that to me is really important. You know, sometimes you just assume that, oh, because somebody's 70, he just stops learning. But I can tell you that this man is more aware of certain things that I am sometimes. Just, and so sometimes when I want to open my mouth to say anything, I just want to be sure that I really am very, very much accurate about what I'm about to talk about, because you would listen. You know, you can talk for 5 minutes and he's just looking at you.
And I've been in rooms whereby young people just be talking and we just listen. And then we just ask a particular question and you see the surprise in their face. And they're like, I thought this man is not supposed to know about, you know, some of these things. And then not until recently I discovered that he reads a lot. He tries as much as possible to read at least a page or two, you know, some interesting book or something interesting, you know, before he goes to bed. And I mean that before he goes to bed was the 3:30, you know, ish I talked about. You know, so when I just get back home and then I'm like, I'm tired, you know, I've been used all day, I just drop my bag and sleep. And this man still tries to read a chapter or two. And then, you know, I get to the house at 9 a.m. and it's up already. When I got the job at the time, I was expecting that I would just get there and I'll discover that I was the youngest person in that camp. So, you know, I was just going to, you know, be using SAP for everybody. I was going to be like the baby of the house. Everybody's saying that this is the youngest person working with Asiwaju. That was what I felt at the time. So, but to my surprise, I got there and it wasn't quite so, you know, and I'm like, I can literally say that, you know, the young people there that are a bit older than me, but, you know, but I can say that the people that do some of the most important work for Asiwaju are young people. Like, it's personal stuff, the young people. Really, the important thing I really want to say in all of this is the fact that the Jagaban I thought I knew, you know, sometime in 2021, is way different from Asiwaju Bola Ahmed Tinubu that I've come to know. Sometimes you're around him and he doesn't say a word for hours. And you know, the team members, the staff members are just there talking. It's not even disturbed. He's not saying, oh, you are making noise or something. It doesn't get disturbed by our presence or make us feel like, can't you see that I'm here? You know, that kind of thing. It's just so welcoming. That's all I can say. So welcoming and so peaceful. I'm in the room with him sometimes and, you know, there are meetings going on. It's meeting people, talking to people. And sometimes in my mind, I'm like, am I not disturbing? You know, I'm always on black, but that doesn't make me invisible. But in my mind, I'm like, am I not disturbing? Like, you know, I expect sometimes that we say, you know, can you leave the room or something? But he has this welcoming aura around him. And he's still one of the people that I've come to see that I've worked with in the political space that has a very good open door policy. In his house, in his office, you find people standing everywhere. Everybody wanted to talk to him at the same time. And then he's talking to them one after the other, listening to people one after the other. And that was one of the first things that made it easy and comfortable for me to be able to work with him or work for him.
I almost forgot that it was Easter, during the period of Easter, because we were doing consultation during the period of Easter. And then I got Easter package, you know, that, oh, the boss is giving the Christians, you know, that work with him, Easter package. And I'm like, oh, even me, I didn't even remember that, you know, we're getting close to, you know, period of Easter. I'm not going to mention names, but I can tell you that at least 50 to 55% of his staff, 55% is not doing justice with at least 60% of his personal staff that travel everywhere with him, that work closely and personal with him, are Christians. I put up a picture a few days to the primaries and, or maybe on the day of the primaries, I think something he said at some point, Elo Fokombale. And that was like the exact description of how he was at that time. And you know, I hear people ask him that, what does he think the outcome of the election would be? And before you know it, his face just changes immediately and he looks with so much confidence and he'll smile and say, I'm very confident, I will win. You know, and you look at him and like, how is someone this confident? And then at the end of the day, the lesson I learned from the primaries that, you know, yes, he had the relationship that he has been building over the years with people that helped strengthen his victory at the polls in the primaries. But he was also confident and he was also hardworking, that, you know, he was ready to do all that it takes or all that it would take of him, he wasn't tired. He sat down there while the result was counted. I don't know, to me, that's a big deal because virtually everyone had left and this man was there. And the lesson for me was there was somebody there that wanted to leave and was telling the other person, you know, let's leave and let's watch this thing on TV. And the person turned to him saying, I can't leave that Asiwaju is sitting down. It says a lot about leadership. One other example is, you know, maybe there are a lot of VIPs in the room that are in the room to see him. And then, you know, we want to probably take a picture or we want to do a video in the room and everybody's gathered around. And, you know, one of the VIPs is like, you know, stand here, take the picture from here. Oh, okay, let us all stand on this, you know, in this corner to take the picture. I should turn to the person and is like, you know, let the professional do the work. That was a big deal for me because you'd expect that me, that was a professional that was asked to do the work, was ready to listen, even if I felt like, you know, it's better off where I wanted to stay. But I felt like, you know what, let me be polite, let me just listen to this person. And it's like, let the professional do the work. And that was a lesson to me that, aside the fact that it struck me that this man respects the fact that I know what I'm doing, or respect the fact that this is my profession, and at this point in time, he would listen to me. Knowing him personally and working with him personally, I would say in all sense of sincerity that, you know, this is someone that I know to be a leader, because I have not had to sit down in front of him to say, you know, sir, if you were to give me 10 or 5 most important life lessons that I need to live my life by, what would it be? And then he would tell me, you know, bring out your pyro and let me tell you something deep. But just by observing him and watching how he conducts himself, how he respects people, how he talks to people, and that's my Asiwaju story.